Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Hashtag Ask Jochen. In this episode, we're doing a live stream lecture with Jochen. And as some of you have asked during our last Q&A, you guys were asking about girths. And Jochen was just saying, you know what, this is going to take me a lot longer to answer. So why don't we do an entire lecture about just about girths? So today we're doing Girth Talk. And without any further ado, let's welcome Jochen into the session today and get started. Welcome, Jochen.
Hey, how are you?
I'm great. How are you? I'm excited about this episode today.
I can't wait to show you all what I got you. It's pretty cool stuff. I have had some wonderful lectures with various veterinarians, body workers, chiropractors. And it's also nice to see how it all comes together. You know, in the end of the day, we would like to do the best for our horses. And the market is just so overwhelmed with girth. And oh my God, what's the right thing to do for my horse? You know, I want to put a horse and a saddle and a rider and a saddle pad together, and I want to have fun and nothing should hurt. And when it comes to saddle fit, you know, big part is the girth, and it's a long topic. You know, and then you see some gruesome pictures like this one on the internet that calls about the superficial thoracic vein. You know, look at this horse here, Mary Claire. That,
oh my goodness,
that looks pretty painful, doesn't it?
Terrible, yeah.
Some horses, you can see the vein sticking out there. And of course, many, many more veterinarians, I use them a lot. You know, they point out and says, look how this person is riding this horse, training his riders, how much he's hanging the horse or what's going on the horse. You got to look at the whole pictures. So today, hopefully we get the answers, because we're always looking for answers. We get the answers to many, many people about the girth, you know, and how should the girth fit and where should it fit. And there's so many different angles you can take. But let's start off by saying, if you look at the horse from the top, I'm just going to take my video off here so you can focus more on the screen. If you look at the picture from the top, this is an image I just got from a colleague of mine who I did a webinar together. He's doing phenomenal work in the UK, Dr. David Mellon. And this is an image where they take a horse on the treadmill and they have they laser horse's back, four different cameras. And they're overlaying, so that's just fascinating. I just took this very quick because I talked in this webinar. If you look at the shape where the saddle sits from the top, okay, so pretend this is the pear, like the fruit, and you want to put a string around it. Where do you think the string goes? Always to the narrowest part. So in the saddle design on the top, we have a tree, but has tree points, what sits behind the shoulder blade. But not only does the saddle wants to go forward, also the girth wants to go forward. So here you see a picture from the bottom. Okay, here you see the elbow. Okay, here you see the pectoralis muscle of the horse. Right, so here you see the only thing what stops the girth from going enters forward is the elbow. And then here you see one layer less, you see the sternum plate. You know, so, and where do we want to have a lot of pressure on the solar plexus here? Do we want to pressure behind the ribs or onto the sternum plate? So saddles have been done for thousands and thousands of years, and we do all kinds of things. You know, we jump, and sometimes the horse gets a little wild, and or it bolts and I fall back, or I do a sliding stop, or I do cutting, and somehow that saddle has to stay in place. So the girth plays a huge role. And sometimes I run into problems. You know, yes, you could have that in the girth area, but this could be ringworm. But here you see thoracic vein, you can sometimes have the issue you have this beautiful cotton string girth, and they're most of the time one of the best girth on the market, but it can girth sore. So is it because the saddle doesn't fit on top, and the only thing what stops the saddle from going over the neck, it's the elbow, because the saddle doesn't fit, it slides forward, horrible in the gullet, in the tree area, or in the tree angle, or in the stuffing, or how the billets align. Okay, so if it doesn't fit on top, I guarantee you it goes forward, and then the elbow is the only thing what is the problem. And then you have this beautiful girth, such as the string girth, and it still causes a girth call. Okay, or you see these hard cases, or like we saw earlier, when they have this nasty issue, where do you want to girth? Preferably no pressure at all. Don't put the D-ring on here, or put it below. No, because if you put it below, you are running into another area. How do we solve the problem if the horse has long-term damage? Is it to ringworm? Is it to very shitty saddle fitting? Is it to now a chronic issue, no matter what you put on? And there's horses, they have so many damaged areas here, all calcified, and so centered, they can't even have any pressure. So special girths are designed, and you see how the webbing is crossed. When I started my saddlery in 1978, we made a lot of these girths. We called them cross girth, okay? And they do have no elastic. So now they're advanced. You see how there is a rubber pad here? You can Velcro them on and off, different thicknesses, and you can have them in sheepskin or leather. So different thicknesses. So this area here does not touch at all the area. So sometimes they come with D-ring, without D-ring. And if you do launch the horse, okay, you see here, there's the D-ring put on. Oops, the meter doesn't play. That's a disappointing. I just did that and it did play. Oh.
Display.
So here we have different stuff. You can see all the calcification. But this girth, let me see if I can make that wider. No, I got to show you this at a different angle. Let me see if I can improvise. Mm-hmm. Let me think here on my heels. So there's my dog barking. Da-da-da-da-da. There you go. Maybe a place. Yeah, here we go. So let's see if I can drag that window in there. That's something new. Okay, so if you have, get away. If you have a horse that has massive damage here in the elbow area, okay, and it's permanent now, and you cannot, here, there you go, and the horse can have any pressure, then you have that cross girth, and it lifts, so there's absolutely no contact. The contact is on the sternum plate and on the side, different pads you like. I recommend not to have side reins or draw reins on it. If you do it, you want it on the D-ring in the center, not on the side, because it defeats the purpose. So you can see here how, oopsie, let me just drag it down, how the skin completely moves free. Okay, so there is absolutely no contact on that area. So sometimes you can see how it's hovering there. All right, so sometimes it helps if it's really bad, okay, to put one of those socks on it. I call them, you can get them in athlete stores for if you have sore. Hang on here. You can see they put this rubber elastic on. You can see how the skin rolls over it. Okay, so there's absolutely no pressure whatsoever on that area. So that is a special girth. What you can use if the damage is so severe that there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. So let's go back to the slideshow I prepared. So on my window a little bit bigger. So that was a new one for me. It looked good on the
great improvising. It looked great.
Yeah, it's like, ah, I can't believe it. what happened? So people always asked me, you know, where do you come up with all this? You know, my horse, he jumped incredible fences. I mean, this drop fence here is 6.5 feet down, and he over jumps it. So my coach gives me shit for this, because now this fence is massively high. As an eventer, I should have jumped this flat and not high. So the impact when the horse lands is, of course, tremendously, you know, and we are dealing sometimes with horses who are not absolutely even, right? So this is the first rip, for example. Okay, so you're looking at the first rip, and look at this first rip, okay, on the left versus the right. See how the first rip and the second rip comes together? That is a big problem. Okay, here's another one. Or we have transitional vertebrate, which is different on the left versus the right side, very painful for horses. Or we have unevenness in the upper arm. What has that to do with the girth? Because you don't want to have the saddle because of deformity in the bones, or you had an accident with the horse. You don't want a saddle that keeps slipping to one side or hanging and banging on the withers there, or girth is so tight and it digs into the shoulder holes. How are you going to do it? You know, the coach points at it, or the vet points and says, hey, you can't do it. You know, you look at the respiratory system of the horse, you know, and this is the vein I was showing you earlier. How can we make sure the horse, when it's exhausted, we don't have a girth on it, what causes more problem? Again, if we look through the different stages, you know, which muscle and what and where should the girth sit? So if you have horses what have a lot of damage, you know, when we just talked about it, there's special girth such as those. Then there's girth what have this big plate and then have this elastic bank in the side, you know, and they have a very short elastic on both sides. They're actually very good too. And out of these girths, there are three girths really bad and one really good. And you say, well, how can you say that really bad? Well, girth it up. Girth it up. And then I'm going to ask you, when you have girth it up, run your pencil on the back. You will see your pencil will break. You will not get through there. All the pressure is directly across this front here. It's completely hanging loose. Okay. So one of the argument was said, wow, this was special designed because this is the abdominal muscles here, and we want to have no pressure on the muscles. This is the solar plexus, and this is the diaphragm of the horse. Okay. So if you look at old saddles, they always had large weight-bearing surface on the sternum. They never cut into the solar plexus or the diaphragm. But they do sometimes say, let me see if I have a better picture. Here's a diaphragm and a couple more veins from the bottom. I got to improvise again, Mary Claire. I can't believe it. Okay.
Doing so great. We're getting comments that are saying really great photos, great great examples. So
yeah, that here we go. This is the one I wanted to show you. Here you see the sternum and the pectoralis. So one of the ideas is when the front of the girth just hangs in the air, this has no pressure, no contact. Okay, so that's the theory. You can say, yeah, okay, I understand. These pectoralis muscles help the horse to move the thoracic sling. Back to my... Oh, Mary Claire, you know me. You can see how stressed I am.
You're doing great, Jochen.
So that's the idea here, so that the front is very, very loose. But if you take all the contact, all the pressure, and you run your pencil through, he says, gosh, is that really good that we put that much pressure towards the back? This is why, if you have a chance, if you own a tack shop or you have a saddle fitter or a company who lets you try all this, you will see from all these, this one here with this plate, distributing the pressure even on the sternum gives the horse the easiest and best comfort. And how can I say that? Who am I? I'm just a saddle fitter. I work with tools such as the receiver girth. I've shown this in many, many of my talks that just measures the data of the horse. This is, I call it the Fitbit of the equine industry, or the Apple Watch. And it measures the heart rate, you know, and if one girth, the horse gets girthed up and the horse is just standing there and boom, instantly the heart rate goes up. Well, he doesn't move. Why is he so stressed? And I talked about this numerous times. So this is the diagnostic, right, where I can measure the heart girth and also gait analysis and stuff like this. So if I can use simple tools like this, and let's just girth up the horse. The horse doesn't even move, okay? And on one girth, the horse normal, doesn't have any problem. And if I'm looking at the respiratory health, of course, the saddle can't slip forward, but where is the saddle pressing? All this is part of the respiratory health, okay? CV17, where is that pressing? Why is my horse creating all of a sudden such a problem when it's girthed up? All right, so I don't know. I'm just a saddle maker, but this makes a lot of sense to me, or this makes a lot of sense to me if I can bypass the sides on the horse's area, what is very, very vulnerable, right? So if I have rib issues, or if I looking at where the veins is, the heart is, and if I have this superficial thoracic vein, here's again a different view, okay? Sometimes I need to bypass the super, super sensitive area. And the industry gives you lots and lots of possibilities and girth to choose from. So my recommendation, put the saddle on. If you don't have a hard monitor, use a pencil. If you can't get the pen sliding through here, and on the other side, you just can stick it all the way through here. Ask yourself, one inch pressure, is it really that good to have all that 1 inch pressure on the diaphragm on the horse? I don't think so. There's many girth on the market. You can see different designs, different companies. This is not one of us, Schleese. It's a competitor, but you can see I really like that. Why? Because it's very narrow on the elbow. And remember, if you girth it up on the left side versus the right side, the pull is very even. This donut, I have to say, I was really curious about this massive donut. And I said, well, I don't know, but I have several clients who use it and they swear by it. And they like it too. Same here, you can see the design, wide and straight. Here, different girth, it opens up and allows that to swing through. So in the different type of girth, the way it's girthed up, Western the same, you know, they have different shapes. The pressure will be always, put a ruler across from buckle to buckle. It's all on the inside. This outer edge, if you don't believe me, try it yourself. This outer edge will be absolutely hanging in the air. So when people ask me about girth talk, I was thinking, how can we make it as simple as possible without making it too complicated? I want you to think about what you're after. You're after putting artificial unit, a saddle on an animal, but is shaped like a pear. The girth wants to go forward. The saddle wants to go forward. The only thing what holds it in the area is the elbow. So elbow freedom is key, but keep the pressure even and wide. Never have elastic more than an inch, triple elastic. If you have a jumping girth, it should be never more in 2.5 inches. Why? Because on the jumping horse, of course, they expand much more. What happens if you have too much elastic? Well, I come back to my heart monitor. That's showing you the horse feels like, uh-oh, every time I inhale, I exhale, I feel like, oh, the girth gets tight. Now, nobody would go and run and does exercises with an elastic band around the chest. Because when we get tired, subconsciously, what happens, your body starts to breathe flat. You don't use the energy to expand that elasticized bra or that elastic band around your chest. Same with the horse. The horse feels the elastic girth, what is too much, too long elastic, is always tight. So they start to breathe flatter. One of the many stories I always say when I was in Europe and I saw this girl who tested all different equipment for the Olympic, in the Olympic training center in Holland, she used a very simple heart monitor, tried this expensive girth, 490 euros, full size elastic, and that was the worst girth and was very popular. And they even had underneath, right here, what touches the horse, a very, it looked like a cross. Yeah, that's just a normal cross that people carry on their chain sometimes. So that cross staked out and was hard, hard rubber. And that cross was digging in right here behind the, actually I have a better picture. It was digging in right on the solar plexus, right there. Okay. And you have tried it before. You said, oh, look at how I can lift up my horse. You go to the horse, you go underneath the tummy, you use your fingertips and the horse lifts the rib cage. Right? See, the horse lifts the rib cage. With this girth, it was sold as, oh, when you have this girth, it will always be, the saddle will always be tight and it will always be loose enough for the horse to breathe. Kind of makes sense. And it has this pressure dome on the center. So the horse will always be engaged. The horse will use the thoracic sling because constantly it pressures on that pressure right here where my mouse is. Sounded good, but obviously that backfired because, as I said, with a heart monitor test and with the constant pressure on the sternum, the horse became very, very angry, very fast. And like I always say, the horse does not know how to lie. Listen to them. The last seminar we had was horses don't lie, or do they? Remember that, Mary Claire? We used this here.
That's right.
And we always say, look at the horse's mouth, the eyes, the ears, they don't lie. So if the horse started to show you disappointment, how does it show me disappointment? Well, the most common one is ears back, wide eyes, or he bites me. But I always refer to Dr. Sue Dyson, who I work with in England. She wrote a thesis on facial expression, the ethogram, okay? And subtle views, subtle movement of the horse can show you, oh, that horse is not comfortable. So if you get your hands on it, or your papers on it, your hands on the papers, I recommend it. I have the YouTube link on that right here. Maybe Mary Claire, you can make it so it goes into the chat room so
yep, people absolutely. Can
access to it. I can only recommend it. Don't wait too late until the horse gives up. Right. So this horse is severely in stress. You can see it in the eyes. You can see it in the wrong musculature in the neck, completely compressed in the thoracic sling. Here's the holding line, okay, a swollen vein. We see this so often. So look at the little things and use your common sense. You know, what do I want to do? Don't wait too long that you need to go to these expensive girths. They work, but they cost a lot of money. So you don't need them. Sometimes you need something very simple. Okay. And for me, very simple is a string girth or the winter girth, nice and flat. And if you have a nice string girth, what really works well, and you say, well, I have a string girth, and it costs a girth sore just like that, well, then maybe your saddle didn't fit. You know, there is only so much the girth can do, even these very expensive therapeutic girth. You know, there's only so much they can do. If your saddle doesn't fit, it's all part of it. Again, look it from the top. Everything wants to slide forward. So it didn't quite cover a full hour, Mary Claire, but I cannot underline again, if the horse has pain, it will drop his thoracic sling. Okay, this is a picture I show many, many times. I show many times if the CN11 gets pinched, you can see the nerve line here. Okay, and when the ribcage goes down, okay, then it pinches the brachial plexus, and then you have the lamenesses. Oh, can the horse get lame from a girth? The girth can only do so much. And if the saddle doesn't fit and hits these nerves, that the horse just drops his thoracic sling, and then you see all the deformity in the neck. So you see here the CN11. Don't wait that long, you know? So back to the girth, keep it simple. Keep a girth what is not too long elastic. The elastic is only there because the horse is pie-shaped. There's circumference on the first billet. So one more time, let's look at this from the top. There's a billet here and the billet there. The circumference on the first billet is always smaller than the second. So you got a saddle, brand new saddle, billets are even. But when you girth it up, the tension is uneven in the girth. So obviously, that's difficult to get. So that's why I recommend half elastic on the end, but triple and very short. The only reason for a short girth for a horse that does not jump is to take the unevenness in the billets. If I have longer elastic for jumping horses, for the moment where the horse explodes over the fence, for that short moment, the elastic should give. Good way to test it when you shop for girth, if you have it. If you can pull the buckle and make the elastic go by hand, well, it's too loose. You'll be surprised the second you run a billet through it, it becomes like a pulley action. And it's very easy to girth. So I can't believe I actually got through, even with all my hiccups, with my videos that didn't play.
But, no, that was great, Jochen. We had a few questions, but I think sure. You pretty much covered everything, actually.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
All right. Then hopefully it helped what I was saying, and I look forward to talk to you folks next time.
Thanks Bye-bye. For tuning in, guys. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.